This week on the podcast, we have
Fallout 4 and Cricket,
Destiny and American Alien,
Bloodborne and Visionaries,
Halo and the story of British Christmas.
Ho, ho, ho! It's a very special, official Team DBAH podcast number 120. Come join us, why don't you? Dun 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 dun. Hello and welcome to the official Team DBAH podcast number 120. It's a special Christmas episode. I'm Charlie Danger 82. Ho ho ho! And with us tonight we got Craig.
Hello.
Yes, and we got Jake.
It's me, Christmassy.
Christmas you, and it wouldn't be a holiday special, kids, if we didn't have our special holiday kid. It's Jamie!
Hello, it's me.
What the fuck?
Yes!
What the fuck, Jamie?
He said, hello, it's him. You said,
still,
hey, it's me.
I've copyrighted gimmick infringement.
This is Christmas. This is our Christmas episode. We can't
That's
have
what
fighting.
Christmas is, copying.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The same thing over and over.
Is that
That's
part
why I'm
of
always here.
British Christmas? Do you guys have Christmas over in Britain?
What kind of shame to this?
Hang on, I just want to say, Jamie, a season of giving, and I was going to give you the right to use my intro, but then you just took it, so you ruined Christmas for yourself and possibly the entire group, so...
Well, that is the tradition.
Oh, okay.
I ain't even mad.
That's the main goal of the British Christmas, is to make everyone upset.
Really?
That's what I heard.
Oh, wow.
So that Happy Christmas thing is just like a sly dig. It's like, Happy Christmas, asshole.
Oh, shit.
Is it arsehole?
It'd be it's arsehole? Like, Happy Christmas, we're having fun, but fuck you.
Wow.
Story of the British Christmas.
Story of the British Christmas.
There's like two different colons in that title.
Exactly.
Do you have any... Will we have Santa Claus for Christmas over here? Do you have any special, like, Father Christmas over there, or...
He's called that. He's called Father Christmas because he likes to celebrate infidelity. Oh. So we're all children of Father Christmas because he gets around while he's drinking.
Jeez. So that song, I Saw Mommy Kissing Santa Claus, is very real to you.
It's a song and a reminder of pain.
Sounds like she did a lot more than kiss, though.
Oh.
Wait,
I'm just...
Is this more than kissing?
Well,
you read into the words. It's, I saw mommy kissing Santa can mean I got woken up by mum and Santa in the bedroom.
Oh,
kissing.
Mike.
Oh.
I never really interpreted the song like that. Wow. Jesus, that is so sad.
It's a big part of the Christmas holiday, so when the time comes around and it's Christmas, most people are happy and joyous. The British, they just remember all the pain, the suffering, the hurt, the cheating. Hmm. And so they take it out on one another.
That's maybe why Scrooge didn't want to celebrate Christmas.
Oh, most definitely.
Oh. Charles Dickens, man.
It's that other guy, the one that was played by Kermit the Frog, because I don't remember his name. Yeah, he wanted to go send
Bob Cratchit.
Yeah, that fella.
And burning, trying to burn his one piece of coal.
Yeah, he wants to go celebrate Christmas, and Scrooge is like, "Oh, you poor fool! Tiny Tim isn't even yours."
Oh my God, because he's Father Christmas.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh God, Jimmy, you're ruining Christmas.
It's like Bob.
It is a holiday tradition.
It's like Scrooge is like, just work on Christmas Day. It helps you get over it. You don't have to see your cheating wife or your kids that aren't even yours. Just work.
Damn.
Is the turkey boy a descendant from Father Christmas as well?
He is and he isn't. He's he's a descendant from Father Christmas, because we all are. We're all Father Christmas children.
Okay.
We're children of the holiday. Saying.
That sounds so fucking eerie.
Yeah, and incest, probably, because you're all getting married to each other.
But the turkey boy is birthed just by Santa and nobody else.
Oh, does he, like, emerge from Santa's head like Zeus and Athena? Artemis? Which one was it?
It's like in that dumb Star Wars movie where Anakin Skywalker is just made by his mom.
Oh, that would be episode one.
Oh, you mean the Bible?
Gotcha. Yeah.
Wait, what?
Oh, yeah, that could tie into the whole Christmas theme. But yeah, that's what Turkey Boy is. Turkey Boy just pops out once every Christmas. You find him on your doorstep and you put him to work.
So Christmas starts Thanksgiving in the UK.
Yes.
Were you doing the math in your head on the days there, Jamie? which comes first, the Turkey Boy or the Christmas?
But it is the UK, so time is not an issue.
Right, time travelers.
Well, that's what Santa is. That's how he gets around.
Of course.
On the and
TARDIS. When I say get around, I mean sexually.
Oh, of course.
I don't know what's happening.
So do the turkey boys do anything special on Christmas? Like, besides obviously being birthed from asexually from Santa?
You're luckier for that, Craig. old chum.
Well, turkey boys have like 1 year of like training to grow up and learn their skill.
Uh-huh.
Only one?
It's kind of sad at first when there's a child carrying a turkey and you can't even see the kid. So
that is sad.
So after the first year, the turkey boy baby has to, because they're born in the North Pole with Santa, and they have to migrate down to the UK.
Uh-huh. And to your doorstep. They migrate to, they pick a home at random, or they have assigned homes?
They're like pigeons. They've got the brain thing.
Oh, they have the brain thing.
Of course.
They have like home, and they just like walk. So in this year-long migration is where they pick up all their skills.
Okay.
And their first day at, first day of job for the new turkey boys is Christmas Day.
Oh, okay.
Oh, so the road is their teacher. that's
Santa's not going to teach them.
Right. Well, of course. He just makes them.
He's too busy getting around on Christmas.
Yeah.
That's why he says ho, ho, ho. Because he's not only what everything I've already said, he's also a very misogynistic man.
Oh
my God.
Well, he's old and white.
Like, he doesn't see. Like, he knocks on a door, he doesn't see a lady. He sees one of his ho ho ho's.
Wow.
I just want to point out that it's not Jamie being misogynistic, it is Santa. So.
It's Santa Claus, exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah, Jamie's not. He's just reporting the facts.
He couldn't make this up.
Yeah. But no. I mean, like.
I wouldn't want to.
So Jamie, like the other the turkey boys who have already like had their training and they've been turkey boys for a couple of years, did they do anything special on Christmas Day for their assigned families, or is it just like another day in the life?
Well, because Santa's too busy sleeping with the mums,
right?
Someone needs to unpack his sleigh with the presents. That's when the turkey boys come in. They dress up like the elves.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
That's why they're short, because turkey boys don't eat.
Okay.
It stunts their growth.
Yeah. The not eating thing. Yeah, that would stunt someone's growth.
But it's all tied in together because they don't just dress up as elves and deliver the presents. They also go down the chimneys. So they deliver like multiple services. They like clean the chimneys, deliver your presents, and then get rid of Santa when he's had enough.
It's a lot different over here. It really is a lot different.
Or is it the same and we just don't know about it?
I like to think that it's different there.
But you don't know.
Neither do you.
I'm just saying. Well, there's an infinite world of possibilities out there, Charlie. It's time to expand your mind. You know, old dog, new tricks. That kind of thing.
No, I'm good. I'm good with my old tricks.
Same tricks.
Same tricks. Same old shit dog, just a different day. Here we go again. To quote another national treasure of Team DBAH, Mr. Earl Simmons, DMX. So, I wonder what he does at Christmas.
Hopefully something like that.
I don't know. What do they let you do in jail on Christmas?
Is he in jail?
Is he back again in jail?
I thought he was.
Yeah. Craig, are you just assuming that DMX is in jail?
Well, he was several times. I just don't know if he is still in jail.
So I just did a Google search for DMX in jail, and the first suggestion was DMX in jail website. I don't know. Oh my God! Wait,
I wouldn't click on that.
There's a website called isdmxinjail.com.
Oh,
have you ever wanted?
That seems reliable.
Have you ever wanted if DMX is in jail? Click on this link and find out. It's a picture of DMX in front of a rolling green hillscape with white light coming from behind him. It says DMX is not in jail.
You heard it here first, folks. DMX is currently not in jail.
I'm guessing this is a
currently.
This is like a live update feed. It says 10/28/15. Judge cut him a break. DMX did not go back to jail.
Oh, well, there you go.
Be great if he just clocked over to in jail.
While you're looking at the webpage. Yeah. It looks like he's not. Oh.
Live from the scene, Jake reporting.
Jake, what do you have?
Currently, it seems like the judge is giving him. Oh, nope. Judge decided not to give him a break, and he's back in jail. Charlie.
Oh, that is.
Back to you in the studio.
should be a weekly podcast.
Craig, how does traffic look through the traffic helicopter?
And there's Jamie with sports.
Oh fuck, this should be interesting. Hey Jamie, what's happening in the sports world?
You don't want me to tell you about British sports.
Okay, now.
You know, one time I did have a British coworker try to explain cricket to me for the entire hour of lunch.
Oh, that's a good spot.
I don't remember any of it though. So I still have no idea what's going on. All I know is that it can take several days to finish one game.
It does, yeah.
Like, they play for 12 hours and then stop and then start again the next day.
They'll play for like 12 hours. Like, one side will be like just hit and the other side will just be fielding the whole time. And then she'll be like, what's the score? 806? Let's take a break. We'll be back tomorrow.
Are you serious?
And they show up and they just take continue breaks? Where they were. Well,
yeah, after, it's like all day thing.
Just because how long? What? The only reason the bats are that long is just so people can like lean on them to keep themselves standing. Some of those people are quite old.
They do look quite sturdy.
What's the age for cricket? Like, when do people start playing cricket? When they're little?
The older or younger than turkey boys?
Yeah. Well, that's the training. You just aim for the turkey boys. That's what they say. If you watch a cricket game, you'll just hear very quietly just the coach or whatever just shouting, pretend you're aiming for a cricket turkey boy.
Wow. And that makes people hit a what I can only assume could be a cricket home run.
We call that a six.
Six.
There's sixes and there's fours. Sixes are if you whack it into the stage of people. Mm-hmm. And fours are if you whack it and it rolls.
Oh.
To a certain place.
See that? Learn something new every day.
And now, you know you've got a six because a man holds up a card that says six.
That's good. That's very polite of him.
And then people clap.
So what you're supposed to hit it, and it's supposed to hit the stick in the ground.
The wicket.
Yeah. The wicket, and then you're supposed to run back and forth. What happens after that?
Oh, the bowler bowls the ball. His goal is to hit the wicket because that's an out. Once he hits that, the guy standing there is out. While the guy standing there just needs to hit the ball, and then he runs back and forth. Each time he gets to the other side, that's a point.
Oh.
It's like a maximum, and there's a maximum of like 6 points. Like if you wax it far enough, it's just automatic six. And then it just goes on and on and on.
Interesting.
But the interesting thing about cricket is that the people with the bats, they have like shoulder pads, they have helmets, they have everything. And then the people who are like fielding and the people who are like meant to be catching the ball, they're just in shorts and t-shirts.
That is true.
Like certain people are protected, then other people are just like, yeah, I don't care.
Interesting.
Did EA ever make a cricket game?
I don't think EA did, but there are cricket games out there.
Are there?
Oh, yes. Historically, there's one that's clocked in as one of the worst games ever made.
Oh. Jiminy Cricket's Wild and Wacky Adventure. That really counts as a cricket game.
Oh, no. That constitutes as one of the best games ever made.
Oh, of course. Still waiting on Jiminy Cricket's Wild and Wacky Adventure 2, Valve.
Oh, I thought you were going to say Pinocchio's Revenge.
Pinocchio's Revenge. The His Blue nose. Fairy Continuum.
Oh, the Blue Fairy Continuum. Cricket.
Try to get about Pinocchio.
What about? What?
The thing about Pinocchio that don't make sense is he's a little wooden puppet. He walks down the street. Some people don't really notice. But then the people that do notice is a cat and a fox.
Right.
Okay. Why the fuck is a cat and a fox walking down the street in clothes and thinking that little wooden puppet's weirder than them?
Because it's a very progressive society, Jamie.
That's right. I mean, it's probably cold there. Right? So, why wouldn't they be in clothes?
See? Always raining. Always raining. So, you guys could purchase Don Bradman Cricket 14 for the PS4.
Wow.
Or the Xbox One, or the 360, or the PS3.
That's going to be Jamie's next reviewed game.
Yeah.
I love it. It's 14. Like they just gave up with one for this year. Oh, should we do a 15? Really? Yeah.
Oh, I thought that there were just 14 of them. I didn't know that was because of the year. Holy shit.
It's the sequel. It's like Final Fantasy. They just keep going and going.
They do that thing that me and Dave did with the TMT podcast where we just jokingly did a number 75, like right after 38. And now we still haven't made it to what would have been 75.
You haven't made it to what would have been like what, 41?
Yeah, we got to exactly 73, and then David's computer killed itself.
Cannot let this future come to pass.
You know what, guys? We still beat out the Team Bottom podcast. Let's hear it. Team DBAH for the win. Christmas miracle. Christmas miracle.
You're a big winner.
TMT. What?
You're a big winner.
I am.
You are.
So speaking of things that just got killed with Dave, we finally beat Dark Souls 2.
No.
We were playing that fucking game since April.
You don't sound like you had a good time.
I did not. I didn't. No.
So it's not like Bloodborne?
No. That game spanned from, like I said, we started in April, and it spanned two systems, because when Dave's computer shit the bed, we couldn't, because he was recording his audio and I was recording the video, and then I would send him the video, he would splice in the audio, and then he sent it back to me. when we switched over to the PlayStation 4, because we had been recording that on the Xbox One, PlayStation 4, since, you know, you could do things awesome with your friends on the PlayStation 4, we didn't have to do that back and forth step, and we just picked up everything. We had to catch up to where we were on the PlayStation 4, and then we had to move forward on it. And to his credit, Dave was trying to be nice. We were about 3 weeks, we were trying to take out a certain boss, two certain bosses, and neither one of us could do it because, well, one, we had to engage the boss alone, and I'm not good at all at Dark Souls. And because, I mean, if you watched the final episode that we just put out, the last three bosses, Dave essentially takes out by himself. He's a monster when, like, he's doing magic usage and everything. He just annihilates all of them. I took credit for the last kill that we did when clearly he shoots a bolt, it dies, and I just take a swipe at its corpse and said, I did it! I killed it! I think he thought I was serious. But no, it's just... We got hung up on it, and one of the things you'll notice through the video series is if there's an NPC talking to me, they'll ask a question after a while, and I'll say, hey, Dave, what were they talking about? Because I wasn't listening. Because I wasn't interested at all in the plot whatsoever. I was just playing because Dave said he wanted somebody to play with, as far as Dark Souls goes. So I just did not care whatsoever. It turns out that we could have ended the entire series roughly 4 weeks ago. But Dave thought I was super interested in the plot. And in order to get more of the plot, we had to beat those bosses.
That's awesome.
The last episode is 14 minutes and 22 seconds long. It's not 15 minutes because I cut out the credits. That we were just... it's done, just thankfully. And in Dark Souls 3, Hidetaki Miyazaki is back doing the design and everything. So he's back at the helm. And he's the same guy who did Bloodborne and the same guy who did the first Dark Souls. So I might actually try out at some point in the far-flung future Dark Souls 3. But yeah, I know no more Dark Souls 2.
None.
No, not more. No, not ever. And of course, there's a tremendous void now in my life because Max, Dave, and myself beat the DLC for Bloodborne, the Old Hunters. So I platinumed the game and I now 100%ed the DLC as well. So now, essentially, my life has no meaning. I am going through what's commonly known as Bloodborne withdrawal.
Ah.
And I think now what I'm going to do is try to play other games. But I'm not going to kid myself because I'm just going to just keep on unlocking the different lanterns you can warp to, and I'll probably, on the days I'm not recording, I'll probably just go and try to assist people in different areas. Because, I mean, it's a wonderful community with Bloodborne. When you need help, somebody is going to be there to help you. When you ring the bell, you may wait for like four or five minutes, somebody will come in, and somebody will help you. And now with the additions of Old Hunters, there are NPCs that can also come to your aid. So if you can only summon one person in, there's usually around a boss area another lantern where you can summon in an NPC so you can have two people fighting a boss fight. Yes, of course, the health of the boss triples because you have three people in there. But at the same time, you have people fighting with you. There's also a pretty good mechanic with it that whenever you call somebody in, there's a bell ringing woman. So PvP never has to happen. It's scripted once in the entire game. But for the entire game, PvP does not have to happen. And plus, that one part where it's scripted is completely optional to go to. So you don't even technically need to ever do PvP in the game. Oh wait, I take that back. No, there's one part where if you don't kill the bell ringing woman that's on the level itself quick enough, an invader might come in. But usually if you're fast enough and can get to the woman, then it's no real problem and you're alone. But if you summon somebody in, it basically opens the door both ways. Like, a player can come in to help you, but the bell ringing woman appears, and if you don't slay her, she summons an invader. So, even though, yes, PvP is there, PvP isn't going to happen unless you have somebody else on your side. So unless you just sit there and ring and summon somebody in just to fight them, you're never going to have to do forced PvP alone. And as soon as you kill the bell ringing woman, an invader can't come in. Like in the DLC, Max, Dave, and I were going into a level, and this poor, just, I don't know what to call it, idiot, decided they were going to come in and try to fight myself, who was on New Game Plus Plus, Dave, who was on New Game Plus Plus, and Max, who's on New Game Plus 5. Needless to say, the invader died.
That sounds like the mechanic that Watch Dogs had.
Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah, because with the hacking thing.
Yeah, like, randomly, you'd be playing through the game, and all of a sudden, like, can't play any more of the mission, any story missions, there's a guy in your game.
If you just That's a lot like guy. Dark Souls 2. Because Dark Souls 2, there was absolutely... There was a setting in Watch Dogs where you could turn that shit off. Dark Souls 2, people could invade whenever. Just whenever they fucking felt like it. And it was really detrimental to making the videos with Dave and I, because we'd be trying to do something to progress the plot, and then some asshole would come in and troll us, like, 4 or 5 times. I mean, we would wreck his shit and send him packing, and then the same guy would keep on invading our game. We're like, dude, fuck off. It's like, it turns from an annoyance to trolling to just plain boring.
It's literally the guy just throwing bodies and bodies of himself at you. Like,
pretty much, yeah. But yes, I thoroughly enjoyed Bloodborne and its DLC. Some very awesome challenging bosses in the old Hunters. And just an incredible game. I still want to play it. That's how much I enjoyed the game. Is anybody else playing a game they completely enjoy lately? We'll start with, I don't know, Jamie.
I wouldn't say, like, I'm playing any games that, like, there's something that I need to be playing nonstop. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know. About last week, for some reason, I just started playing Halo 2 on Legendary. Because it was one I never did. God, that made me want to hate myself.
Right.
So when you just start it, like, it's like the type of game where the elites will just kill you with 3 shots. It's just crazy. Like, games like Halo 2 and games that old, like, their campaign on harder difficulties isn't the best. Like, it isn't balanced. So, like, it's almost like you just have to, like, it's like things like checkpoints. Like, you take down, like, 6 enemies, and then the final one gets you, they're all back. Like, there's no, like, you can't run back, you can't make a checkpoint happen. If you run out, you can easily run out of ammo with all the weapons in the room, and the enemy's just got unlimited ammo. Just, like, things like that.
Yeah, and conversely, if you have a player that's an absolute fucking horrendous beast with you, you don't even get to really pick up ammo or anything like that, because they're going through checkpoints, like, at warp speed, like when Craig and I were playing with my cousin Anthony with Halo 4 on Legendary. And we just walk into places and just dead things all around. It was like when... It was sort of like when we were waiting for Max to come into our world in Bloodborne, and then we realized he was already in the world because all of a sudden we started getting XP because he was off in the distance. He had just gotten into the world and he just started killing things. He was like Doomsday.
The ultimate.
He just
baby.
Landed in the world and just annihilated. But yeah, I mean, I thought that the legendary campaign in the first in Combat Evolved, I thought that was pretty balanced. Then again, I would only ever go through with my cousin.
I'd say Combat Evolved would feel more balanced because a lot of the weapons were a little bit more overpowered.
That's a pistol.
I mean, this, yeah, like the pistol, the even like weapons like the rockets and the needler, they're just pieces of the crap in Halo 2.
Yeah.
That's your needle. You can dual wield the whole thing, like release like up two like pretty much full clips, and it just won't do a thing. And then some brute will just carbine you, and you'll be dead instantly.
Yeah, I agree. There's a couple balance issues with Halo 2.
But yeah.
Are you enjoying yourself though?
I did that. I mean, I've done it now. I'm done with it. I'm happy. It's like it's not like something like I set out to do. I just like felt like doing it, and I'm kind of happy I did it because it means I've at least once in my lifetime I've beaten every Halo game on the GD, which is
nice.
Something cool to think about. But yeah, besides that, I'm still going back and forth with Halo 5. The most recent update for Halo 5 came out today as well.
Yeah.
Like they've just added Forge, they've added new maps and stuff like that. It's pretty cool.
Now I heard that you completed the legendary campaign with Dave.
We did. We caught the campaign, yeah.
And to quote him, by the end of the game, you wanted to wrap each other's necks around each other's throats.
What?
Yeah.
It doesn't seem physically possible.
Well, he was trying to say we want to wrap each other's hands around each other's throats, but he said that, and then he completely saved it because I said, necks around each other's throats, yeah. Am I right? And he goes, yeah, we fight like giraffes. And he totally turned it around and saved it. And then all I could think of were two giraffes fighting with Jamie's head and Dave's head. And it made me laugh for at least a day.
Good for you, Dave. Good for you, man.
Good for you, Dave. Go get him, Tiger.
If only Dave's computer was broken, he could make that into a comic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, Dave, there are many, many benefits of you getting your computer fixed.
Or stealing a fixed one, like the one that's not broken. An unbroken one.
Or buying a new computer.
I mean, this is the season. You just go to Britain and just steal someone else's and just say Happy Christmas, and
that's forgiven. That's not even right.
Okay. I guess I misinterpreted Jamie's lessons on British Christmas.
You so did.
Well, you didn't involve a turkey.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's still a turkey boy's computer, then.
They can't afford computers. They're turkey boys.
I assume they stole one.
They don't even have houses.
Oh, shit. Not even houses?
Where did they shelter themselves? The computer's
coming. Oh, shit.
They'll sit out there on your front lawn, with like an umbrella, sneezing, eating the snow.
As one does.
It's both a drink and a meal.
That's true.
Absolutely that's right.
True. And the best thing, zero calories.
That's right, unless you put syrup on it or sugar.
Or pee.
Eight. Yes.
Occasionally, you will lean out the window and be like, don't eat that, that's yellow. You'll get fat.
You'll get fat. You don't want a fat turkey boy.
Yeah.
Craig, playing anything lately that that you're enjoying thoroughly?
Please. Unfortunately, I have not got a chance to play Battlefront lately. But I had did start playing Fallout 4 on Steam. Because I found a birthday like coupon code like buried in my email. So I used that and got it for 27% off. So.
Oh, shit. That's not bad at all.
No. I forgot that playing Fallout makes you a very, like, vengeful person.
Oh.
In the game.
How so?
Because I set up Sanctuary. It's all good. And they're like, well, go talk to these other people and, you know, help them. Okay. And, you know, in Fallout, there's no... No one really ever goes from point A to point B. It's like you walk around, you go from like point A to C, D, R, F, T, you wrap around H, and then maybe go to B.
Absolutely, yes.
So I was doing that, and found some cool things, like a railway station, a plane that crashed. And then I see up on a highway that's, you know, destroyed. There's like a giant windmill on top of it. I'm like, oh, there has to be something up there. So I start walking over there, and I see like two people, NPCs, like walking around. And it says Gunner above their head. And there's a little white skull like painted on a wall with a like a weird mark on its forehead. It's like, all right, there's just two of them. That's not bad. And I'm like, well, maybe I could talk to them. Yeah, that was a mistake. Because as soon as I walked in, there two more showed up out of somewhere. They all started shooting at me, and they had a turret set up.
Shit.
And they had grenades. And three of them were throwing grenades at once. And it wasn't good. Wasn't good. Nope. So I said to myself, all right. And what also really pissed me off is it was my own fault. I didn't save for like 10 minutes.
Oh.
And in Fallout, that's a very bad thing.
Very, very bad thing.
So I said to myself, okay, well, I just lost, you know, everything I just found. I'm going to go back and get my power armor. I'll be right back.
Oh, no.
So I went and got that and came back. And now everything up there is mine.
Oh, cool! They saw the error of their ways and just gave it to you.
They moved. We'll just say
they moved.
I always wonder what the story behind like characters like that in video games are. Just the people who just hang out in odd locations for like hours.
Yeah.
It's like just a gang of four people, and they're just like, "All right, boys, this is the deal. I'll paint the skull on the wall. You set up the turret, Gary. When the guy comes, we all throw our grenades, shout, he'll leave. Job's done." Like, what do we do once he's gone? Well, we got the windmill.
There you go.
Can we use the windmill for sank? No, but it looks cool.
Not even a door on it, no. No.
One of the guys is like, "Can I go back and see my family?" "No. We stay here now. Can I call them and maybe say tell them to come join us here?" "No, we're good here. Just the four of us.
We're your family now.
Just four guys in the middle of the wilderness with a windmill. That's how it should be."
They're all like reformed turkey boys too.
Mm-hmm.
Guys, did you ever actually eat a turkey? It's actually pretty good.
Then they turn around and shoot him and accuse him of being a cannibal.
Like,
crazy. Fucking horrible.
We are turkey boys. We eat snow. their tongues are like just completely like dead because all they eat is snow, so it's just like complete numb. They have no taste buds.
So Jake, what you playing, man?
Destiny has officially become my kryptonite.
Oh no.
And not for like strikes or raids or all the normal stuff that Destiny people do. It's just the daily bounties, man. Just the daily bounties.
Those help you go up.
Those, it's not even that. It's just like, oh, this is offered just once today. Then I need to do it today. And I have to do all of them. All of them that I can feasibly do. There's like Like I generally kind of do all of the whatchamacallit, the regular bounty stuff and like the SLR racing. And then I've gotten decent at Crucible now. Like I used to be god awful and would barely do any, but now I've gotten decent. I have to do all those now. It's a rough life. I foretold this day was coming. I said, you know, daily quests were my kryptonite, and now my kryptonite is destiny.
I
like how your kryptonite's a 2-year-old game.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, it's too bad Rayon's gonna have to get a PS4 and get Destiny.
It's still real
too
to me,
bad
damn.
For him.
Part of his responsibility to help you with the raid.
I tried that the Sparrow League Racing there.
Yeah.
I loved it.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. And
they really went in for it for a free update.
Yeah. I'm sorry that it's only around for such a small time. And I'm really sorry that the only purple gear that's actually worth a damn that you get from it is the helmet and the, like, either bonds or hood or
mark
a dish towel.
Yeah.
But I'm especially when I got to like, you know, I saw like, oh man, if I complete this level, I can get the purple gloves and the purple boots. Awesome. And they are just cosmetic,
or they help you out in races. There's some that do that.
Yeah, you see, I need purple raid gear if I'm ever going to be worth a damn in a raid.
You mean on a PS4 when Randall has it?
On the very same. For you too can use magic gem and go poof, I am 25.
For the low price of $30.
Now you can pay for that.
Yeah, and now I don't have to even worry about going through the horrible year one content. I can just go through all the new stuff. Hey, the game's cool now.
Essentially, yeah. I'm saying, like, last year, the story was kind of crap. Do you want to just skip it all? Here, just skip it all. Just pay. Yeah. Give us some money. You can skip all the bad stuff. Go on to the good stuff.
I got to the end of the year one story. I thought it was, like, the first boss.
Yeah. Right.
I thought like, oh, okay, this is so, the first like end of the so first like, park maybe, or and then I was in a party with Dave at the time, and Dave was like, no, that's the end. And I go, are you fucking kidding me? Are you for real right now?
Oh, so that's why everyone hated Destiny at first.
Yeah, this was nothing.
God, I can't remember. What's the actual final boss in Destiny?
Giant statues.
You fight the three statues, and then you shoot at the ball.
Come alive.
Does anyone ever know? Does anyone actually know what the hell was up with that?
No.
There was the giant eyeball. There was
because they could explain,
but they won't.
But they won't.
Nah, we don't have time for that.
And we wish there was time to explain that there's not time to explain.
You've heard about this, no? Well, I mean, you've heard rumors about it. No?
No.
All right, then. See you later.
Well, why don't you go over to Bungie.net so you can know all this stuff? No.
I feel like Bucky Destiny... I feel like Destiny's story is like if you just started playing, like, the first Halo game was Halo 3. Like, you literally started with just the Chief falling from space, and then you, like, right. Actually kill the Arbiter, and the Arbiter's just like, we're on the same team now. Like, if that was the start of Halo... The first Halo game, people would be so damn confused. And that's pretty much what Destiny is.
Yeah.
My first Halo game.
You start off dead, you're alive.
Was Halo 3. And I was damn confused.
So was mine, actually.
You're
so anyway. Halo 3, I was like, I don't want to play as Master Chief. I want to play as this alien guy. And get to Halo 2. And it's like, wow, they knew. They already had this planned.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway, so that's my kryptonite. Speaking of kryptonite.
Well,
guess what came out today?
Well, I don't have to because I already know, but why don't you tell people?
Superman American Alien issue number 2 came out.
Blah, 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 blah.
Yep. And it's really damn good. It's my book of the week, and the week that I forgot not one but two books off my pull list, I just realized. I told Charlie that I forgot about Miss Marvel. I just didn't pick it up when I was in Comixology, and then like I saw more pictures and I was like, wait, Unbeatable Squirrel Girl came out today. Shit, I missed that one too. So those two will be going on next week.
Yay!
Which, in my defense, that would mean I had to review 7 books this week. Absolutely. So
I'm glad to stick with just 5.
Too. Mage Killer would not have been on there if I had gotten those other 2 books.
Yeah. But yeah, if carrying on with the grand tradition of issue 1, issue 2 was it was great.
Yep.
I just
as Charlie texted me before I'd even read it, he goes, "Man, shit got real in issue 2," and I go, "Shush."
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Shit did in fact get real.
Got very real. Some might say a little too real.
I think it was fun.
What was I gonna say? I you know, after, if this does well, I hope that they let him do create his Superman world and let him do the Death and Return of Superman that he pitched to DC.
Yeah, that'll be interesting because there's a lot of stuff in that video that I'm kind of like, how would that work? How would you portray that? And I'm sure he's got a plan. I'm sure he converted it to a speech format. Like, because there are some things that like don't match up with how presentation in comics works. But it would be interesting to see how he changes those things. And also, it'd be a kick-ass story. So,
and of course, if you guys don't know who we're talking about the second national treasure of Team DBAH that we're bringing up this episode, Max Landis. He writes American Alien.
Jake, is this one in prison?
No. No, he is not in prison.
Yeah. Let me see if that's a website. Max Landis in prison. Jail.
It'd be great if there was a website for every celebrity and some of them were just completely dead. It's like, you're just like, is Elvis in prison? Oh, he's dead. Oh.
No, but strangely enough, Max Landis once tweeted about DMX being in jail. So a little bit of crossover right there.
And the cat's like in the knew. Cradle and the silver spoon.
Yeah, it's like he knew.
If he brought up Garrus Vakarian and Yuri Lowenthal in the same fucking tweet, I'd be convinced that he was part Jesus. So. Sorry. It's been a long day.
So who's ready for Star Wars to get spoiled for them? That being social media.
Yeah, goodbye to social media for the next, until I see the movie. So
I haven't looked at anything.
Craig's going tomorrow night. Or Craig's going tonight, actually, because this goes out on Thursday. Craig's going tonight.
That I is.
That crazy shit.
Yeah, I think I'm probably going to go on Saturday.
Yeah, I'm going to try to go on Saturday.
Like, I don't want to because I want to ride this high of, like, Star Wars is about to come out, you know? Like, kind of how I'm not going to watch the last season of Parks and Rec because once I watch it, it's over. In my mind, it's always on. But, like, I think I'm going to have to see it early just to avoid spoilers.
Wait, Parks and Rec is over?
Yeah. Spoiler alert.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Is that the one with Chris?
Yeah,
How the hell did they explain him not being fat?
he
says he stopped drinking beer, right?
Yeah, he stopped drinking beer, and that was it.
Yeah. When he got super ripped when he became Star-Lord, it's like, hey, why'd you lose so much weight? I stopped drinking beer. It was like a throwaway line.
Did you work out? He goes, no, I just stopped drinking beer. I'm pretty sure that's it. That may not be it. I'm making that up.
I like that. That's pretty good.
I'm scared for the new Star Wars.
Yeah? Well, I'm you so know what frightened. They say about fear, right?
Fear leads to hate, hate leads to anger, anger leads to a big boner you can't get rid of. Yes, I know. fear is the Viagra. No, I'm just so scared that I know in my head I'm going to walk in and I'm finally going to see these friends that I haven't seen in like 20 years, and it's going to be monumentous and tremendous. I just hope it's handled well. And I know in my heart it will be, but there's still that part of me that's trepidatious about seeing it, because I want this to be so good. And I just, maybe I'm just setting my expectations super low.
Which is probably a wise move.
Because the last any, three films.
So that means any good thing that happens is going to blow me away.
Makes sense.
But, yeah, I stopped watching any trailers because they were just giving away way too much.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, I can't believe Doomsday's in the movie.
Yeah.
I know, he's dressed like a Ninja Turtle.
It's that shared universe now. Disney, just, you son of a bitch.
Just Haunter's Chewie's like, is he with you? And then Chewie just growls.
Doomsday the Hutt.
Doomsday the Hutt.
It's a very
rich. We shall have a Wookiee Superman. Ho ho ho. Okay. I saw the Batman's v Superman trailer, and it made me want to see the movie even less than I did before. So now I have completely no desire to see the movie.
I feel like however, because the movie's built around the concept of the fight between Batman and Superman, and you already see what happens after that.
Yeah, you see the reason why they team up. Like,
yeah, it's like, don't make a versus film and then actually be like in the trailer, oh, but that's not the main focus. This happens afterwards.
Honestly, yeah, so
I think it looks ridiculous.
I think I'm going to go see it just for Momoa's Aquaman. And then as soon as I think that he's done on screen, I'm just going to walk out. Which is probably going to be the end of the movie, so it'll be good timing.
So, you.
That wasn't a joke. I'm just saying that's probably going to be the end of the movie where he shows up, so...
Apparently Flash is in the movie now, too. A costume designer came out with that. So it's like six superheroes in the movie now.
I'm trepidatious, to say the least. However, there is a superhero, or there's a comic book movie coming out next year that I really, really want to see, because... The Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle 2 trailer came out, and contrary to all the snorting, hooting dickholes on the internet, I really loved the first one. I thought it was refreshing. I thought it was a really cool take on the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and the second one has Casey Jones and Bebop and Rocksteady in it. Sold. Crazy. Here it's I come.
I love the idea because Casey Jones can be a very grounded villain, like, or not villain, big character, because he's just like a normal guy. It's like hockey gear. And then you've got like a rhino and a warthog.
Yeah. Right.
It's like just chugging everything and seeing what sticks.
And,
which is the exact approach that Ninja Turtles needs, because that's what it was based on.
Yeah.
Like the 90s series was like, let's sell toys.
Steve Amell is that's what I believe his name is. TV's Green Arrow is playing Casey Jones, and it looks like they had a lot of fun, so I'm on board. Definitely did see it. The new Star Trek trailer debuted.
Got everything to debut.
The Beyond Darkness or into
Beyond.
Into beyond the Beyond.
It's just
Beyond Two Souls.
Into the Beyond Two Souls Darkness?
Yes, Beyond Two Souls. Star Trek. It's a very, it's a crossover you didn't see coming this summer.
You could definitely tell that the director of Furious 7 did the directing for the movie.
Oh yeah, and that talky techie sci-fi. Yeah.
Yeah. Very pretty albino girl, though.
Very pretty. I thought her character design was very cool.
Very cool. Very awesome character design on that.
I can't wait for her to be reduced to a love interest. That'll be fun.
I can't wait for that random scene where she's in her underwear for perfectly good reason.
No. J.J. Abrams is not directing this movie. But and conversely, the Independence Day Resurgence trailer came out.
They're back.
Welcome back to Earth.
I like that movie, but I was working at the movie theater when that came out.
I saw that movie like three times in the theater because of the trailer that was in front of it.
That was a good trailer.
That was a good trailer. It was for the re-release, right?
Yes.
Yeah, who knew that the re-release was actually going to suck so much? Anyway. Can't believe I spent $21 to see a trailer for a movie where Greedo shot first. Fuck's sake.
Here's the thing about the Independence Day sequel, though. It's like one of the few ones that actually makes sense. Because in Independence Day, all they do is crash all the ships. Doesn't mean all the aliens are dead. Like, they're still all alive in those ships, probably.
Right.
So they don't, they like semi-resolve the conflict in the movie, but they're still like, oh, massive cleanup operations underway against this force with still superior technology. Like,
God, that'd be really sad. If they blew up the spaceship, it crash landed, all the aliens were still alive, and then just murdered everyone. Like, they're all celebrating, and the aliens just walk out of the ships and just start killing people.
Now we're stranded on this planet. Now we're even angrier.
Now you're going to build
and now we're the Turians.
Slaves.
Yeah. You will be assimilated.
Can you imagine if they take off their second mask and they're actually just Turians? And Independence Day leads into Mass Effect? That would really turn around my opinion of Independence Day Resurgence.
This summer, the second crossover you didn't see coming.
Well, Craig, we're about to see a lot of we're going to see a lot of crossovers pretty soon in the movies, huh?
That you didn't see coming?
They are.
What's going on with that?
Hasbro is going to start doing crossovers in their movies.
Oh, good.
Oh, what? So you can have G.I. Joe and Mask. Not the depressing movie Mask? From the 80s. Mask the toy
Jim
line.
Terry?
No,
not
that's
that one
the Mask. We're talking about Mobile Armored Strike Command.
Okay.
With a K, not a C.
Okay, for the edginess.
Look, the 80s were strange times. And seeing as though Matt Tracker was released as a G.I. Joe figure at one point.
It was. There's the Visionaries and the Micronauts.
If they make a Visionaries movie, I will go to the theater every single day. I will watch that movie. I will quit my job. And I will watch a fucking Visionaries movies for fucking days, because let me tell you something. Visionaries were my fucking jam. They came out at the perfect time, at the height of holographic technology. There were these knights with the same articulation as a G.I. Joe figure, but they were taller, and they all had holograms on their chest and staffs with holograms. And when they said a magical phrase, which I knew every single one of, the totem that they had on their staff would spring out of the staff and fight and use their special powers, like decay or strength or wisdom or anything like that. They would jump the fuck out. And the visionaries themselves, the knights of the magical fucking light, they could turn into the animals that were on their chest. I was so into this fucking series.
They were pretty cool.
Fuck yeah, they were cool. Could you imagine if they bring the Centurions in?
Did Hasbro own them?
Hasbro owned everything back then, I think.
That's true.
If you can make a toy out of it, Hasbro owns it.
Oh my god, if they made a Visionaries movie.
So here's a question. Speaking of 80s TV shows I haven't seen, when are they making that gritty reboot of Silverhawks? That's all I want in life. Ever since
fucking
I saw
Silverhawks rocked.
Ever since you introduced me to the theme song, all I want is like a gritty reboot of that. Because like
I don't want a gritty though. I
mean,
want
don't
to
they
shine.
don't they like get have like false prosthetic limbs and stuff like that? Like,
kind of. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like 90% of their body is partly metal. The other is slightly partly real.
Partly real. Silverhawks.
I love that partly is part of that theme song.
Partly real. The other part's imaginary.
Partly metal, partly real. Silverhawks. Little known fact, Rawhide or Bluegrass. Bluegrass was the leader of the Silverhawks. The dude with the metal mohawk and the cowboy hat and the guitar.
Yeah,
he was the leader of the entire place.
Oh.
Quicksilver was just the field leader.
Oh. To be fair, if I was a guy with a mohawk and a cowboy hat, I would let him be in charge.
sort of like if we had Metal Randall.
Wear a cowboy hat. Can we
get Randall a cowboy hat? While he's setting up his PS4.
While he's setting up his PS4. Mm-hmm. You know? He's from out west. He probably has at least 3 cowboy hats laying around.
That's right.
At least.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And he'll have to do something because his car's frozen. So.
Yeah, that.
PS4 then. That's it.
I can't get my head around that, by the way.
Speaking of crossovers, I made a discovery that I didn't know about until this week. Well,
you made a discovery that you didn't know about.
Concerning crossovers, they make it like that. I didn't realize that there was full-on plans and like announcements and everything of a Godzilla / King Kong universe.
Yeah.
Yep.
That kind of shocked
fucking
me.
Crazy,
I didn't
right?
actually know there was a. I didn't know there was a King Kong Godzilla movie planned for 2020.
Yep.
It's crazy.
They
I can't
wait for.
Not,
I can't
the
wait
first
for.
Time they fought.
I can't wait for 3/4 of that movie to be taken up by humans. That'll be fun.
Oh god, real talk. That fucking Godzilla movie.
Dude, that last quarter is some of the best, like cinema.
Yep.
Ever, but like the first 3/4 of it is just garbage.
Holy shit, just garbage.
It's like I don't care.
I don't care about Quicksilver banging the Scarlet Witch.
Yeah,
I really don't care. Just let me see giant monsters fight.
If there's like you know how they edited the prequels into like one movie, like I want someone to edit the Godzilla movie into just like. Cut out all the Quicksilver Scarlet Witch stuff and just like put the scenes where like the monster gets teased a whole bunch. Like, yeah, do that please. Yeah, and then just the last part of the movie. Give me the TV version. Sorry, what were you saying?
No. The thing would be 20 minutes long. It's just
It'd be a great pilot for a TV show.
Really would.
I like how the tagline for that movie was "Let them fight," and that's pretty much what people are shouting at the movie.
Yeah.
Here's the thing: Ken Watanabe was like, let them fight. And then the American Army didn't listen to him, or the Navy, whoever it was, the military.
The Breaking Bad didn't listen to him.
No, he tried to get himself... He got himself out of the movie as soon as he could.
Yeah, he did. Right. He was like, oh, they're going to fight the whole time? I'm out. See ya.
It's like I'll die now. We'll do some crap with my son, and then we get to them fighting in Hawaii.
But we will advertise the fact that I am in this movie heavily.
Heavily, even though I'm in here for like 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And really Ken Watanabe as well.
He only showed up to collect the paycheck.
It's probably the best 10 minutes of the human part, but yeah. Get me out of here.
What irked me the most is when they were about to show the big fight, and then they cut away, and it was just on a shitty fucking TV screen somewhere. Oh, yeah. I'm like, are you fucking serious right now?
Tease.
I paid actual money to watch this film, and it's... Oh, maybe. God, no. I was looking so forward to it, too.
Yeah, but... You get to the end, and you get to like him using his atomic breath down that thing's head and decapitating it, and you're just like, okay, that's what my money paid for, just that bit.
Man, Pretty much.
The theme is like, da-nah. Yeah, it's great.
It's like you paid for that, and you paid for Ken Watanabe to just look at the camera and say, Godzilla. That's all you really wanted.
And let them fight. Because it was in the fucking trailer, like everything that they showed was Bryan Cranston running down a hallway and Ken Watanabe saying, let them fight.
Maybe he wasn't even talking to like the actors in the scene. He was actually talking to like the directors, like, hey, stop all this bullshit. Let them fight.
They were fighting over there, and Bryan Cranston's like, you know, this movie really has no direction. Maybe we should talk to them and get them to stop and let them fight. Okay. If you say so, man.
Sure thing, Ken.
Fuck Bryan Cranston. Bryan Cranston read the script, and he's like, he's in the movie for the rest of it, and it's like all this drama between him and his son. He's just like, and they start recording the scene, he just falls down and it's like, oh, I'm dead. Now we have to film Godzilla.
You're supposed to be in like four more scenes. Oh, no, I'm dead.
And
who dies.
He pulls out a prop gun, tries to shoot his son. He's like, oh, my son's dead too.
But aren't you already dead? Shut up before I pick the real one out.
I just want to see Godzilla.
Well, I hope that you guys, because this is the season, are taking the time out of your busy schedule to watch some great Christmas movies like Die Hard and Gremlins.
Iron Man 3.
And Iron Man 3.
Take place at Christmas.
Does it? Totally forgot.
Do you know what doesn't take place at Christmas?
What?
Frozen.
That's true.
Are you still mad about that, Jamie? You need to let that go.
All them fucking kids watching Frozen.
Oh, I see what you did there.
It's like, oh, it's my Christmas movie. It's not Christmas. It's a summer movie where it gets cold. That's literally every summer in Britain. It's just singing about it.
You should turn to the directors of Frozen and say, do you want to fucking go, man? Sorry.
Just like that.
Just sing it at them. Because if anything I've seen about the people of the fine United Kingdom, they really enjoy their singing about fucking everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Chimney Sweep, let's sing about it. You and Nanny, let's sing about it.
Especially with animated penguins.
Absolutely. Hummed a little bit, hummed a lie. If you're Scrooge.
I'm walking to the bank. Let's think about it.
Exactly.
My favorite Christmas Carol movie has to be the one with Albert Finney. It's a musical one. And it has a song called I Hate People in it. And I grew up watching that song, and I think it kind of molded me into who I am today. Strangely enough. So, we would love to hear from you guys, the audience, what your favorite Christmas movies are. You can leave it in the comments down below. Who knows? You might win something.
You probably will, because, you know, we want to make you...
Because we love giving out presents. at Christmas time. That's the
reason. Like Santa.
Yeah. Well, not like American Santa, not like British.
Like Santa. American Santa, not like British Santa, please.
I think if I gave out presents like British Santa, I'd get arrested.
You would.
Yeah.
Because the presents you would give out would be babies.
People hate babies.
So many babies. Oh my god. All right. So Craig, do you have any Christmas wish for the audience out there?
I think my Christmas wish would be to watch Steve Martin's Christmas wish list.
Oh? Mm-hmm. I don't think I've heard about this.
Oh, no, from the old Saturday Night Live.
All right. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. My Christmas wish, mine especially, would be to have a Team DBAH special that would be highly reminiscent of the old, like, Bing Crosby and, you know, Rich Little Christmas specials, where, of, like, the 70s and early 80s, where they'd be just like, you know, oh, we're gonna, you know, set a fire in the fireplace, and ding dong, who could that be? Oh, God, it's David Bowie. He just came by to say hello. Oh, I just came by to say hello. Hi, guys.
I'm David Bowie. Christmas I just came to wish you a Merry Christmas.
Yes, and stuff like that, and just like, you know, oh, here's the mailman. Oh my god, the mailman is really Harrison Ford. You know, stuff like that. And
there's a snowman waiting out on the lawn.
That was really good.
Let's film this thing. Was. Let's do this thing.
And like, just instead of celebrities, it's just long us. Dead has-been celebrities.
Oh, David Bowie's still alive.
Yeah, I know, but I'm talking about like
Harrison Ford, also still alive. Neither the plane crash nor the cocaine killed Harrison Ford and David Bowie, respectively.
No. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about the other people who were in the specials. Anyway.
It's like there's a knock at the door and it's the girl from Matilda. It's like, goddamn. What have you been doing recently? Nothing, really.
No, just like, you know, oh, the mailman's here. Oh, it's Jamie!
Jake Lloyd.
Like, it's Jake. Holy shit, the Team DBAH Christmas special starring the girl from Matilda and Jake Lloyd.
Yeah, it's just all child actors that are, like, done.
God, I love the way you think. And us. Child actors that are done, and us.
It's just us, the girl from Matilda, Jake Lloyd, and Macaulay Culkin singing.
Jesus Christ, he's not coming into my house. Well, we no Macaulay while... Culkin in my house.
Well, it takes place in one of those houses where there's only three walls, and then a big group of people that just watch us.
That's true, very true. That's kind of creepy, but...
It's in one of those houses where everyone walks in and looks at the exact same space. Like, looks in the exact same direction, same wall. And then... talk outwards towards the wall.
Like, no, I would so just glad. Love... I want the Team DBAH Christmas special to happen so badly. I want just, like, all of us to just, like, have walk-on roles or what have you, or singing musical numbers. I just want that to happen so much. Mainly because I would love to, like, meet everybody in real life and hang out for an extended period of time and make videos with everybody. Make video game videos with everybody and stuff like that. And like sketch videos and all that shit. I ideally that would be just so wonderful. That's my wish.
Jake, I'd
follow that up.
I was gonna say I would do it, but I'd want to have a dance scene where literally I walk on in like the outfit, then I just disappear behind a wall and a professional dancer takes over for me.
I can make that happen.
At the end, like, he ducks down, I jump up, I'm like, what I just did.
We can make that happen for you.
My Christmas
Jake, any Christmas wishes for you?
My Christmas wish is that everyone else's wishes would come true.
Wow, because my list has a lot of wishes, so...
It does. That's very generous.
Team DBAH bless us, everyone.
We have the Brit here to do that.
I still have to go.
Fuck.
Exactly. Jamie, do you have any Christmas wishes that you'd like to tell anybody?
I wish that Dave would get his computer fixed.
That's a pretty big wish. That, you know.
The realest wish.
The realest wish.
starring Jamie.
Spotlight done on Jamie.
Featuring David Bowie.
It's been like 6 months.
Does that include the little Asian guy that was behind him in Labyrinth?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Okay.
Jamie as played by David Bowie.
Fix your computer,
Dave. Oh, David,
Dave.
Get your computer
fixed. Fix your computer,
fixed.
Dave.
We really need your computer now. So.
It's a god-awful small affair, says the boy with a broken computer.
How much do you think we'd have to pay for David Bowie to put on the outfit he wore in Labyrinth?
Not much. He probably still hasn't.
Yeah, I would say he probably still hasn't.
For God's sakes, bring it to Geek Squad!
That's the high mark of Britishness.
I'm so glad we could get David Bowie for our Christmas special. It makes me so happy.
2 years in a row, dude. This year, and then the live action video with Macaulay Culkin, Girl from Matilda, and Jake Lloyd.
Absolutely. And DMX, and Max Landis, and Yuri Lowenthal. And fuck it, we'll bring Brandon Keener in. Everybody knows he's the voice of Garrus Rogerion.
Can we get the Muppets, but not the voice actors?
I don't see why not.
So it's just like
Muppets just staring the entire time, moving their heads, but not the voice actors.
It's just like Kermit and Miss Piggy sat in the corner who can't do anything because no one's got their hand up.
Ah, the silent scream of the Muppets. Can't scream if you don't got a voice, Muppet. God, that's creepy. Wow.
That's kind of creepy. Wow.
Rain me in. Wow. Anyway.
I think we just found out what will be the start of the Christmas special. Camera fades in as Charlie stroking Kermit and saying that.
And Kermit's just trembling uncontrollably.
While Randall's watching on his PS4.
I think we know another wish for Craig is that Randall would get a PS4 for Christmas. Not for Randall to go out and buy a PS4 for Christmas. We just hope that Randall gets a PS4 for Christmas.
Right, because how else is he going to play games by a certain producer of said games?
Oh my god, that's right. That's right. Hideo is making his own company and doing an exclusive for PS4, isn't he?
Yeah, he is.
You guys,
they drove a dump truck full of money up to him and said, here.
Dump truck full of money, TM.
That solves all the problems in the world.
I'm glad the free Hideo 2015 campaign got in before the new year came. Then we'd have to change it.
That's true.
I'm just glad he managed to chew the chains.
He's pretty wily. He could probably find a way out of those chains without actually chewing them.
He escaped with the use of a cardboard box.
Oh my god, that's right.
He probably had some kind of equipment that was probably made out of some kind of like steel or iron, so like some metal gear.
He's just using everything. They run up to him, they're like, Kojima, we found you, he's wearing an eye patch. They're like, oh, sorry. thought you were someone else.
Did you see the interview? The guy from Sony, him and the guy from Sony?
No.
Because it's kind of interesting, because the CEO that he's talking to, I'm pretty sure he's British. And then he starts speaking in Japanese, so it kind of just throws everything off.
I really got to give really big props to Jeff Keighley, because at the Game Awards, he was the one who actually said, yeah, so Kodami basically told Hideo Kojima to stay home and not to come to the Video Game Awards, so I just want to tell Hideo Kojima, that we're thinking about him, and that, you know, you really did an awesome job with the game, and we're really sorry you couldn't be here tonight. He basically outed Konami in front of everybody for being douchebags. So
they're gonna like go down now. They're not gonna recover.
They're gonna just. It's gonna be bad for them.
They're gonna go the way of THQ.
That's sad though. THQ had some really good games.
Except THQ doesn't make, was it, slot machines? So I think they're gonna be fine.
And pachinko machines.
Well, excuse me. Yes.
And hey, Jake, did you ever see the commercial that Nicolas Cage did for the Japanese pachinko machines?
I did not, but I'm about to as soon as this podcast ends.
Yeah, you're going to enjoy yourself. But anywho, folks, guess what time it is?
What time is it?
Christmas.
It's time that we wrap up because Santa will be here soon.
Oh, what? Dear.
That's like...
No. Oh dear.
When's this podcast coming out? Wait.
It's coming out tomorrow. It's coming out. Look, it's the Christmas episode. We're not recording the week of Christmas, okay? If ABC Family can do the 25 days of Christmas, we can do the podcast a week early and call it the fucking Christmas episode, Jake.
I don't think that's the same thing. My favorite
part of Christmas.
It's exactly the same thing.
I just imagine Charlie like just shouting at the top, shouting like screaming, "We'll celebrate Christmas when I say so."
Now, the week of Christmas, folks, a podcast will not be coming out, so we want to give you guys the Christmas special early. And
that's your gift from us to you. No podcast. That's bad. Yeah. You love a full update in your podcast app.
Or have they been really good this year?
It's hard to tell with them sometimes. Good, bad, we're the guys with the guns.
Or the podcast. Just the guys with the podcast.
Well, yeah, I was doing the, you know, Army of Darkness thing, and then I realized he's got a gun.
I was right there with you. I thought you were going to change it at the end, but you know what? Good on you for remaining on book.
I'm sorry I buried the lead there. Am I using that right?
This isn't the New Year's podcast, silly. This is the Christmas podcast. This isn't the year-end recap. That happens in 2 weeks. Anywho, folks, thank you so much for your love and support. We really do appreciate it. We appreciate all the downloads, all of the comments, and everybody who's reached out to just at least even say hi to us. We really do appreciate y'all. If you guys have the time, if you could please swing by teamdebah.com to check out everything that is Team DBAH, including this very podcast that comes out every Thursday with a rotating cast of awesome people that's available on Stitcher, SoundCloud, iTunes, and Player FM. You can find a link to our store, cafepress.com/teamdebah, where you can check out our merch. You can check out every Wednesday the pull list that comes out from Jake over here, where he tells you what comic books you should be reading for the week. And, of course, over here on my right, we have Jamie, who puts out his monthly loot crate review. So look forward to that. And, wait... Jake, did you say something to someone?
No, didn't say anything.
I thought I said the pull list wrong.
Yeah, I just made a joke about missing two issues. So.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's all right.
But yes, look forward to next week's pull list where Jake will be returning with the two issues that didn't make it in this week, but read it this week because there's a hell of a good review of American Alien by Max Landis.
Every other and, review, shit.
And of course, if you click on the banner up on top when you get to teamdebah.com and sign up for Audible through our website, you get two free books for free, as opposed to just the one free book for free. And that's pretty cool, if you ask me. But anyway, thank you, Craig, for joining us tonight.
Well, thank you for being you.
I try. Jake, thank you for traversing the landscape to make this possible and be on here.
Yeah, it's snowing a lot here. I had to hike up a hill both ways in the snow. 5 miles or something.
That's weird. I thought the power just went out in your house and you had to go to your brother's house.
That's what happened.
Oh. Sorry, man.
Yep.
But it was snowing, right?
Yeah. Snowing right. Sparks out of the transformer. Yeah.
And of course, Jamie, thank you for staying up ungodly late so you could contribute to this, the Christmas special 2015 of Team DBAH.
Next year, live from a studio with Mar Wilson, Jake Lloyd, and Macaulay Culkin.
And David Bowie.
That happen. And David Bowie. Absolutely. It's going to be so cool. So, thank you very much, folks. We'd like to say a big Merry Christmas from everybody here at Team DBAH. I've been Charlie Danger 82. This has been the official Team DBAH podcast, number 120. Jamie, take it away.
May the Force be with you.
Wrong. Take it away, Jamie.
God bless us, everyone.
Good night.